under which there are 133 controls. So let's see what are the different standards available in this ISO 27001 family. ISO 27001 family. So here in the slide, you will be able to see ISO 27001 standard is about requirements. The list of requirements we need to have in the company to have an information security management system. There are set of other standards which was again put together by ISO body, which is again about. Okay, which is again about. Which is again about ISO 27001 itself. There is some problem. Okay. So ISO 27002 is nothing but a standard which helps the organization saying that these are the best practices organization should follow. And the 27001 talks about, okay, these are the guidelines an ISO implementation auditor or a surveillance auditor should follow. So ISO 27004 is talking about this is how we should measure the metrics of ISO 27000. Family of standards. And 27003 is talking about implementation, how we should do implementation of those information security management system. And 27005 is nothing but a derivative of DS7798, where it talks about the risk management, how it is carried out well. And 27006 is talking about how the certification scheme should be managed, how we should apply for a certification based on ISO 27001 standard, and how we should maintain, how the whole of the certification schema should be managed. So 27000 is nothing but a overview and vocabulary. So there is whole sort of family of standards in the ISO 27001 itself, which is always associated to ISO 27001. So here we saw some of the domains in our earlier slides. Here we are seeing what are the different controls under those domains. So for example, so ISO 27002 helps the organization to follow best practices. So 27001 and 2 is very much associated hand in hand. So now here we are seeing asset management. Let's try to go into the details of the asset management domain. So in a infrastructure, let me take an example. So we have an IT company who wants to claim that they want to go for a ISO 27001 kind of information security management system implementation and followed by a certification. Ideally speaking, what they need to do is first they should put the policies together for the organization. The policy should comprise a lot of standards, lot of guidelines, lot of procedures according to the organization's convenience. Once after they got the policies, list of policies according to their organization's different assets, they need to put a organization, information security organization, they need to establish who is the information security manager, who is the information security head, who is the chief information security officer, and they need to establish how they are going to liaison with the rest of the divisions inside the company. They need to establish the structure and reporting. And once after this policy and organization is established, then we need to figure out how the assets are being managed. We need to take an inventory of all of the assets of the organization, saying that, okay, my organization have this many assets, IT assets, software assets, other set of assets. And this is the different classification level of the organization. For example, some assets are falling under highly confidential. Some assets are falling under low confidential assets. So, and also we need to determine who exactly is the owner of different assets, which team is owning, which person under the team is owning that particular asset. So we need to completely form a detailed inventory based on the classification, ownership, and different fields according to different the classification type of the cluster, we need to collect a lot of information to put that inventory together. Once after all these three in place, we need to figure out how we are able to establish human resources security. In human resources security, we need to figure out, okay, before the employee joining the company, what are the different controls we are taking care of? So whether we are doing background check, whether we have established the roles and responsibilities for the particular person, whoever is going to join. And once after the guy employee is on board, whether we have given awareness and training and education session, what are the policies and processes he should follow with respect to information security, what are the applications he would be able to access from the premises of the office, and what are the applications he would be able to access from home, whether he is really eligible to connect from home, etc. And even when he is leaving the company, so what are the processes he should follow, how he should grant, give back the access, whatever he got, and how he should transfer the list of activities, whatever he was carrying out, to another person. And then he kind of even gives back the assets, whatever he owned, to the appropriate department. So these are set of controls. There are set of 9 different controls under HR security. So once after HR security, what is the thing we are going to do is determined. We should think about physical and environmental security. In physical and environmental security, there are certain aspects like physical access. Okay, in the company enterprise, there may be different rooms. The IT company may be having a data center, may be having a development cubicle, may be having certain set of cubicles assigned for testing team, maybe certain set of cubicles assigned for architectural team. So when there are different cubicles assigned for a different set of teams, different access policies for those different regions should be determined. And where we should be able to clearly say that, okay, the guy who is involved in architecture need not have access for data center. Only the system admin or the network admin team is going to have access for data center. And the guy who are working in data center need not have access for the rest of the places inside the company. The architectural team need to have access for a development team's cubicle. The development team in turn does not need to have access for the architect team's cubicle. So the physical access for different areas need to be determined, and a policy need to be put, and also appropriate controls need to be implemented. That's when the physical and the environmental security domain is assumed to be completed. So along with the physical access, there are a set of other controls. How the air conditioning, how the fire and water safety is taken care, how the power supply backup is detailed. So these are other aspects of physical and environmental security. In case of any disaster, how we are going to kind of bring back the company to operation, or how the employees are safeguarded, and along with the customer data, and how we will be able to make sure that operations can be brought back immediately without any delay further. So once after this is determined, so we can think about our next domain called communications and operations management. In communications and operations management, it is about how the backups for different machines are taken, how logins of different activities are done, and alerting is done. For example, so we may be using antivirus software across all of the endpoints, desktops in the organization. How that antivirus console, which is monitoring all of the desktops antivirus installations, is getting the latest antivirus updates definitions, and whether this antivirus console is really working properly and alerting us whenever there is some desktop is impacted and not kind of took the update definitions, antivirus update definitions, whatever that server console has sent to that machine, and it is trying to create some problem, whether that antivirus console is capable to alert. So this is nothing but one control. And there are controls like patching. So how are we making sure that different softwares and different hardware, different operating systems, different network devices, what different kind of things we use in the enterprise infrastructure are patched appropriately with respect to latest vulnerability information coming from the technology vendor. So we may be thinking that only operating systems comes with patches. So it's not true. It's a myth. So even Cisco network devices, whatever we may have bought some 4 years before, may be having latest definitions, the latest updates coming from Cisco itself. Now all the technology vendors, so always comes up with a list of vulnerabilities, security vulnerabilities on their different software or hardware and different systems, whatever they have manufactured, and they release patch also. So how are we making sure that our organization is patching those latest vulnerabilities? We need to have a process. And we need to have a monitoring process as well. And how the configuration of different machines are taken care. And how archives are managed. This and all comes under communications and operations management domain. And when it comes to access control, the next important domain. So how physical access is managed, how network access is managed, how systems access is managed. Do we have a process for applications access? Do we have a control for functions access? Do we have a procedure for data access? So these are the different things, questions what we should ask our own selves and implement appropriate controls, procedures, processes in turn to make sure that we are following all of the controls falling under this access control domain. Why it is important? Let's see that. So for example, we are taking again the same example of the IT company. The IT company may be developing some product for their customers. So they have got a big outsourced product development order from United States and they are working towards it. So if they don't have kind of a data security control implemented in all of those machines where they are developing the product for the customer, so there is always scope for the leakage of that intellectual property from those machines. There are certain, let us assume, there are certain set of developers working as part of that outsourced product development order for the IT company. So they are already on the pipeline of leaving the company. Process of joining another competitor who is operating on the same area. So when there is no real control put in place in all of those machines, there is no data loss prevention or encryption solution, kind of the information security solution implemented in those machines. You think about this situation that a developer able to share the code to his own Dropbox folder from the machine wherever he is working on, and once after he joins a new company, he is able to download the same set of code, all set of code whatever he has developed in that old company, that the old company's intellectual property without any hindrance he is able to reuse it. And even the second company, if they are wise enough and if they are operating on the same space, it gives them a big edge. And in turn, the old company who were relieved that employee is in a big loss of intellectual property. Probably they are not even aware that the employee who were left has taken the code along with it. Lot of companies these days, whenever we go talk to different IT companies, they say that they don't need information security management system. Their operations are small. They say that we are a game development company. We have developed a game which is selling for 1 crore, and we have only that game available in Apple marketplace. What is the need for information security management system? What is the need for information security control for us? And when we ask in turn, okay, how are you making sure that your code is protected? They say that they have trust on their employees. So as a technology company, we cannot say that having trust on our own employees is the only way we are making sure that our data and our customer data is protected. But that's not the way we should be saying it. We should always go extra mile, see what are the different security solutions we will be able to put in place and help the customer hand over the data to us and have that assumption that it is in safe hands. So we should, if you have hesitation to invest on proprietary solutions, there are always open source solutions, security solutions available which can help the organization. For example, there is something called OpenDLP, data loss prevention, which can help the organization protect their data being lost to somebody outside the network. So when they have that OpenDLP kind of solution put across the organization, they will be able to monitor, okay, different important kind of extensions, files, which is going out of the network. And next comes the software development. So when a company is involved in software development or systems development, so there may be different phases we may be handling: requirements, design, develop, and then test, and then implement, and then maintenance and support. Different phases. What are the different controls we need to put in place on the different phases of software development or systems development? Also comes under ISO 27001 and 2 as well. So how are we managing incident management? So that's a very important domain we need to be determining, and this kind of carving out clearly as a separate process for the organization, because so there can be different sort of security incidents happen to the institution. For example, we may be aware of the LinkedIn attack, where the huge set of thousands of LinkedIn usernames and passwords got leaked. So how the organization like LinkedIn handled the situation, whether they went under the carpet saying that there was no attack, and they kept quiet, silent, saying that that this is a wrong information, or they came out very clear. Probably we may have seen in the newspapers and all of the news articles saying that they have accepted that they got attacked, and they said they are working on it. Then immediately after, they came across this incident. And post taking back the controls of all of those systems which got attacked, they said they are going to work with those set of customers who have got attacked and helping them reset their passwords. So they have put a kind of strategy, and they came out very clean to the public saying that they got attacked, they have put a plan now which, through which they are going to mitigate the situation. The situation mitigation is very important in incident management. And post which, after a post-mortem, they said, these are the set of actions we have taken now. So now going forward, this is how we are going to make sure our systems are protected, so that nobody will be able to get into our systems. Nobody would be able to predict the way we are generating the passwords. So these are the different things they have said after that incident. So similar to the security incident happened for LinkedIn, there are always security incidents we see in newspapers. So, but for example, even there was an attack recently happened in Pune and Bangalore, where the Indian payment gateways, couple of Indian payment gateway companies got attacked, where in turn there were no press releases from the particular companies. And also post the incident, even though there were monetary losses for one of the Gulf banks, there were no clear-cut communication. What is it, how they are working out that compensation or mitigation for those customers who were got impacted? There is no clear communication after that incident. That's a very bad way of handling security incidents. So let us see, after security incident management, there are a set of things we should talk about: business continuity. So the business continuity is a thing where we should define how organization would be able to recover from any natural disaster in case if it is occurring in that particular premises where the company is operating, and how the organization is resilient against different things, the calamities which may occur. So there are different ways we can do this business continuity domain. So for example, while I was working in IBM, So we used to conduct tabletop exercises for different divisions. So in case the Bangalore operation, there is some big political hustle happening in Bangalore, how the operations for those set of customers who taking service from IBM Bangalore is able to get their operations sustained by set of teams operating in IBM Hyderabad, how that can be managed. So we used to conduct tabletop exercises through which we make sure this is how the disaster recovery can be managed. So I am going to next slide.